Hi, Stephen Hamm from the Stakata School of Defence. A couple of weeks ago I put up a video about the surviving evidence for how people fought with large shields, and a few viewers came back and said it'd be really good to see some techniques, so I'm doing a video showing some of the techniques that we see in Taupoffa, that we also see in 16th century Italian sword and rotella manuals, and that we see in pictures of people from earliest times right through to the 18th century. So, let's start with how you hold the shield. We certainly see the shield held flat against the body in a lot of images of mass combat, and we're told by people like Morozzo, he says hold the shield flat against the body when you're up against multiple opponents. But he's very specific in saying, if you're up against a single sword-armed opponent, hold the shield edge out from the body. Now, if we look at some of the more accurate pictures, we see that the shield isn't straight out. If we say that that's 0 degrees and that's 90 degrees, the shield's about 70 degrees. If we look at the more accurate pictures, then we can see there's a distinct angle. And my rule of thumb is point your shield at the left shoulder of your opponent. Now, let's have a quick look at some of the techniques you can do. So, if I get Sean here to hold, we'll go through some of the wards. If you hold your shield flat against your body, I've christened that the medium ward. If we hold our shield out from the body in the correct ward, I've christened that the outside ward. If I parry to the inside by stepping around the shield, I've called that the inside ward. And if I parry by stepping forward and raising my shield up, an image that we don't see that much in medieval fighting, but we see over and over and over again in ancient depictions, I've called that the high ward. So we get outside, inside, medium, high. Now, if Sean's in the medium ward, much beloved of reenactors, what's the problem with that? The main problem is that I can pin his shield against his body. He can't do it anymore. And meanwhile, I can stick his point pretty much wherever I want. If I do it properly, if I do it really well, I can actually take my shield and my point can just go straight into him in single time. So even if he holds his shield out a little bit further than that, right, I can still take my shield around until it reaches that critical angle where it's pointing at my left shoulder, where it's really not possible to move your shield there. If your shield's a little bit more open, then I can actually start hooking. And if your sword was up there, I'd hook it by coming in into a high ward. If your sword was maybe a little bit lower, I might hook sword and shield. I might hook it by going into a medium ward. Alright? But I can hook his shield open. If his shield's pointing at my left shoulder, I can't do either of those things. I can't press the shield, I can't hook the shield. I can move around and create angles and do it that way, and that's what a lot of the shield fighting is. It's moving around, fencing with the shield, and trying to create angles where you can hook or press the shield. Let's just take a step back from that and look at how you deal with the basic attacks. One of the things you see in Taupoffa is that when people are making defences, they're in these long lunging positions, okay? And that's quite deliberate. If Sean attacks me, if he attacks me with a high blow outside the shield, right, I'm going to come in with a long lunge and that leaves him quite open. And I actually pulled that up a little bit because I didn't really want to knock his shoulder right off. If he attacks a bit lower, he's standing sort of, if he attacks with just the low cut, a standard reenactor, cut for the legs, standard reenactor, up and down, okay? That's really inefficient. What I can do is, if he goes for the legs, I can come in and smother the arm, okay? And that way, it's not that different to block the high attack versus the low attack. So I'm blocking the attack at its source, not where it ends, right? Not at my head or my legs. I'm blocking it at the source. That's far more efficient. If he attacks too straight down at my head, I can do a high ward. And if he attacks to my inside line, inside the shield, the side of the shield, then I can just step around the shield. Just as if I move a sword, it can be deceived. If I move the shield, it can be deceived. So instead of moving the shield around my body, I move my body around the shield. That's far more efficient. So, that's a few of the techniques. I want to have a little bit of a look at curved shields. And I wrote about curved shields in the paper I wrote in Sparta 2 in 2005. So I'll pick up a curved shield. Now this isn't a very deeply curved shield. If it was a really deeply curved shield, I could just parry by just stepping around like that and just covering my line. This is a gently curved shield. So I'm going to hold it somewhere like that. Now, you really don't want to try and press a curved shield. You're tempted to if it's a shallowly curved shield. I didn't follow my own advice when I was up against a guy a few months ago and got clobbered a couple of times when I was trying to bind his shield. So we try not to bind a curved shield because it's just too easy to, if you try and bind it, just to roll around it and, right? Or simply to, as he's trying to bind it, just cut up underneath the arm. Alright? So, binding curved shields isn't anywhere near as effective as binding flat shields. But hooking curved shields, if I hold my shield so that this edge is pointing towards his left shoulder, then my shield is horribly open to being hooked. Right? And I just hook it. So if he hooks it and goes into a medium ward, I'm gone. So where do I actually point my shield? Instead of pointing this edge at his left shoulder, I point this edge at his left shoulder. So if I lay my sword along there, you can see that that's a fairly straight line from that edge of the shield through to his left shoulder. Right? So I've got my shield a little bit more closed than it would be with a flat shield, but still this edge of the shield is pointing straight at his left shoulder. Alright, and I'm a lot harder to hit. And I can start hooking his shield, okay, and we can have a lot of fun. I'm not going to go into a huge amount of detail about how to use curved shields. Okay, the last thing I want to look at is some comments made in a recent video by my colleague Paul Wagner about Viking swords. Now this is a really nice replica I've got of a Viking sword from about 850. And what Paul was saying is that the crossguard is so short that really the main use for it is to prevent your knuckles from being matched either against the back of your own shield or against your opponent's shield. And while I think there's some truth in that, the crossguard is also useful for some other things that I want to show you. Now, once in a blue moon, maybe once on average in a fight, we will get blade-to-blade contact in a sword and shield fight. And maybe one in 10 of those contacts, the blade will slide down and you'll be protected by your crossguard. Doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. Something that's a little bit more common than that is if I attack the legs. Now, I'm not going to do this with my shield because that would obscure what's happening. Obviously, I'd have a shield in a real bout. If I attack the leg, Sean will come in and he'll try to stick his shield into my armpit and prevent me from striking. So what I often do is I will come in to attack the legs, and then as he's coming in, I'll bring my sword around to try to strike him in the belly. Okay, which is actually a technique that comes out of manuscript 133 with sword and buckler. What Sean can't turn his shield to the inside ward because he doesn't have time. Once he's started to go for my right armpit, all he can do is to push his shield across to his right, to my left, and jam his shield down onto my sword. And it ends up something like this. Now, if we look, we can see where's his shield ended up? Right on my crossguard. Now, the very first time that Sean did this to me, I ended up with my sword about that far away from his belly, and I thought, damn, my crossguard has stopped me from hitting him in the belly. And then about 10 seconds later, I thought, no, actually my crossguard has stopped his shield from mashing my hand. Okay? So my crossguard has actually protected me. Alright? So that's another good use for the crossguard. So just to recap, what have we looked at in this video? We've looked at the shield guards that we see in historical manuals, the German Fechtbucher, the 16th century Italian manuals, and in images right from earliest times right through to the 18th century. We've looked at the basic defences you do with a flat shield. We've looked at some of the things that you can do or can't do against a curved shield. And finally, we looked at a little bit of commentary on what Paul said about the Viking sword. So hopefully this helps you if you're reconstructing either early or later medieval sword and shield combat. Thanks for watching.